My name is Britt Braaten, and I work in programming and interpretation at the Canadian War Museum. It's an honor to be here today to speak with you about a recent project, the Human Library, for which we received the Governor General's History Award for Excellence in Museums, History Alive. I'm going to start by talking a little about the context in which we put on the event, and then I will tell you more about the event itself. As you will learn, the Human Library is a highly adaptable event. Although every Human Library will contain elements of autobiographical storytelling and breaking down barriers, as you'll discover learning about our experiences, the actual content of a specific Human Library can be easily adapted to the needs of a particular institution. So it's my hope that some of you here today will take this idea with you when you go back to your museums and historical heritage sites and host your own Human Libraries. So with no further ado, here's the story of the Human Library at the Canadian War Museum. Oh, how do I flip the slide? Nope. Sorry. There we go. So, the Canadian War Museum is Canada's National Museum of Military History. It is located in Ottawa, which is the capital city of Canada. Founded in 1880, it moved to its current location on the bank of the Ottawa River in 2005. The museum works to increase public understanding of Canada's history of military history in its personal, national, and international dimensions. So one way that we do this and that we try to make our history relevant to visitors, and it's a theme that's come up today, is by telling the stories of individuals. So an example, one of the most powerful and popular artifacts in our First World War gallery, the small teddy bear named Teddy. Teddy was a gift from 10-year-old Eileen Rogers to her father, Lieutenant Lawrence Rogers, as he served in the First World War. She hoped that Teddy would keep her dad safe. When Lieutenant Lawrence Rogers was killed in battle in 1917, they found Teddy in his pocket. They returned the bear to his family in Canada, and today he lives at the Canadian War Museum. Now, school children across Canada write letters to Teddy as part of their Remembrance Day activities. The museum contains interactive spaces, as well as some more traditional artifacts of military history. In all, we hope that our visitors come away from the museum understanding four key ideas. First, that war has affected Canada and Canadians. Second, war has affected my life in Canada today. Third, war is a devastating human experience. And finally, I must remember. So, those are the ideas that inform the exhibitions and the programs at the Canadian War Museum. And our story of the Human Library begins with one exhibition in particular, Peace, the exhibition, which was scheduled originally to open in late 2011, although it was ultimately delayed until mid-2013, and that's part of the story we'll get to. Peace, the exhibition, talks about Canadian action for peace at home and around the world. And it talks about individual Canadians as soldiers, as diplomats, as demonstrators, as community leaders, and in countless other roles. Like so much of the museum, we try to do this by talking about the stories and experiences of individuals. So some of these stories we tell are of people who chose to fight for peace. So for example, we have the passport of Edward Komodowski, who defied Canadian law to travel to Spain and fight fascism in the Spanish Civil War. He felt that by fighting, he would make the world a more peaceful place. We also tell stories of people who chose not to fight. So for example, we show the boots worn by Mennonite conscientious objector Elman Lichty as he performed alternative service during the Second World War because he wanted to make a contribution but didn't think that the path to peace was through fighting. Some of the things we present in this exhibition as action for peace will surprise and challenge our visitors' conception of what it means to act for peace. And so throughout the exhibition, we invite our visitors to share their ideas and their reflections on what it means to act for peace in the world today and how they define peace. So where does the Human Library fit into this? Well, to tell you that story, I have to go back in time a bit and tell you about the history of the Human Library. So the first Human Library took place at a Danish music festival 13 years ago. Titled Stop the Violence, it brought together a group of volunteers to act as human books and share their stories from their life with strangers. These human books represented different stereotypes that about whom people might have misconceptions or negative opinions. So some of the human books at the very first Human Library included a refugee, a rapper, a police officer, a football fan, and a gay man. Festival goers were called readers, and when they came, they were given a list of all the human books. They would review that list, pick one that they wanted to have a conversation with, and check this human book out like you would check out a book at a library, and have this one-on-one conversation. The idea was through this interaction, they would begin to see these people as real people and look beyond the label that they were wearing at the event. So at the War Museum, we thought this idea was a really great, had a great connection to the peace exhibition, where it would really, by giving visitors a chance to speak one-on-one with people who took a very large variety of action for peace, visitors would be able to see how, even if people made a choice that you yourself would not have made in those same circumstances, that you could see the genuine motivation and the genuine desire for peace in their actions. So, we started work on the Human Library in mid-2011. At that same time, we discovered that the Ottawa Public Library and the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, or CBC, were in the early stages of planning their own Human Library. So the three organizations, got together, and a partnership was born. Each of the institutions played a different, played its role. The library and the museum would host the Human Library, and the CBC took care of promoting the event. At the library, the program planner was the lead on the museum, selecting the human books and ensuring that event logistics were organized and went well. On the day of the event, the program planner was joined by volunteers, interns, and a few museum staff to ensure that the event went smoothly. The Human Library took place on January 28th, 2012, at the Canadian War Museum and at five branches of the Ottawa Public Library. When our visitors came to the museum, they were presented with a booklet listing the 19 human books available at the Canadian War Museum. Some examples of those books are Carl Kletke, a field engineer who cleared landmines in Bosnia, Irina Szpak, who had, as a girl, been a member of the Polish resistance in the Second World War, Karen Bailey, an artist who traveled to Afghanistan to paint Canadian military personnel, and Abdul Kadir Youssef, a Somalian refugee who worked with Doctors Without Borders before moving to Canada. Some of our readers came full of questions, others came mostly to listen, but regardless of how the interaction went, the effect was the same, which is that the readers really came to see these people as individuals with complicated identities and really fascinating life experiences. The human book, or human library rather, is really about encouraging and enabling connection between our readers and our human books. So why is this special? I've already said, we weren't the first human library. We were, however, the first that we heard of that took place in a museum as opposed to at a library or a community festival. And that, it makes a real difference. So, in two ways that I can see. The first is that the museum tends to be held up as a place of authority. It's a less democratic institution than a library or a community festival. So the act of bringing in these, you know, regular Ottawa Gatineau people, not specialized scholars, giving them space within the museum to share their story and empowering them to do so in a museum, it's made that much more significant because you're lending them sort of the credibility of the museum in a way. In effect, what you're telling them is, you know, your story is part of history. Your story matters. And that was pretty special. A second thing it does that is significant is that it helps our visitors, the readers, expand their idea of what it means, what are the borders of military history, what it means to study military history in two ways. And the first is that at the Human Library, we had human books whose experiences were reflected in our permanent galleries. So for example, a veteran of the Second World War, and they were right alongside human books with more recent experiences, like someone who served in Afghanistan. So what this did was it really helped our visitors see more recent events as part of a larger story of Canadian military history. A second thing is that the Human Library brought in people whose lives had been profoundly affected by conflict, as civilians as well as soldiers. And it really helps people, our visitors, see that military history matters to everyone. It's not just something that matters to the military. So I painted a pretty rosy picture so far. We found an idea we liked. We adapted it to suit our needs and found that in so doing, we'd created something pretty special. But what challenges did we face? Where was the drama? There were two main challenges. The first was an internal challenge, and that's that the exhibition calendar got shuffled, which means that the date we selected for the Human Library no longer coincided with the peace exhibition, which was the whole reason we were hosting the event in the first place. This was resolved relatively easily. We decided that in 2012, our Human Library would be focused on stories of military history more generally, and were it a success, we would host it again in 2013 while the peace exhibition was at the museum, and at that time we would choose stories related more directly to peace. The second challenge had to do with the partnership we were in with the library. As I've said, it was important at the museum that the human books available there had stories to tell about military history. So the content of the event had to connect to our mission and mandate as Canada's National Museum of Military History. The library had no such content requirements, and for them what was important was that they bring in a group of stereotypes that would sort of encourage and promote a real meaningful conversations and questioning stereotypes and that sort of thing. So they, some of the human books they had were, they had a mother of 10, they had a drug user, they had an anarchist. So it was a very different slate of people than what we had at the museum, which meant, I mean, you know, there were obviously lots of similarities in the experience of the event at both locations, but it meant that there were some key differences in the experience and in the goals of the event. So what, you know, at the end, after we did this event and we're debriefing, we all recognized this difference and decided to host separate events going forward. So the Ottawa Public Library and the CBC hosted their second Human Library on January 26, 2013, and the Canadian War Museum hosted its second Human Library on June 9th, 2013. So, our second Human Library. So because Peace the Exhibition opened in May 2013, in June 2013, we themed the Human Library around peace stories. So some of the human books available in 2013 included Kuzma Tarasov, who worked as a peace activist for 50 years. We had Viviane Jean-Baptiste, who traveled to Haiti to work as an interpreter after their most recent devastating earthquake. We had John Anderson, who worked as a scientist researching the effects of nuclear weapons during the Cold War. Glenn Hodgins, who was a diplomat who has been recognized for his role in peace talks in Sri Lanka and in Afghanistan. And we had Myrna Nightingale, who sheltered American war resistors who had fled their country for Canada rather than serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. So that's just a taste of what we had. The Human Library is now an annual event for the Canadian War Museum, and we intend to keep linking it to our temporary exhibition. So in 2014, we're going to link it to the exhibition Witnesses, Canadian First World War Art, by inviting in human books who can speak about their role as witnesses to significant events in local, national, and international military history. So lessons learned from the Human Library. I can speak pretty concretely in that, by looking at the changes we made from the event in 2012 to 2013, and sort of two stand out. The first I've already discussed, so we chose not to have a partner in 2013, just to simplify the organization of the event. The second that I think is quite significant actually is in 2013, we made a real concerted effort to ensure that the human books we had reflected the diversity of the National Capital Region in terms of age, in terms of gender, language, religion, race, sexual orientation, and so on. Why I think that's so important is that there, especially I think with military history possibly, there can be a public perception that it's really the exclusive domain of older white men, in Canada anyways. So we wanted to really, you know, subtly, visually, but deliberately show that military history affected Canadians, a broad swath of Canadians, all Canadians, actually. The Human Library, it really represents excellence in programming at the Canadian War Museum in four key ways. So the first is that the event was welcoming and inclusive. Human books and readers both commented about the warm and inviting atmosphere of the event. And the second way that it represents excellence is that it connects to the other activities and elements of the museum. So in 2012, it was military history in general, and this interaction with real individuals really highlighted our overall message of war as a human experience. In 2013, the association was even more direct, as some of the human books were talking about experiences that were referenced in the peace exhibition itself. The third way is that it was fun. We chose human books with a good story to tell. We chose human books who were good storytellers. So the readers really enjoyed the experience of hearing what they had to say. And the fourth way is that the experience, it resonated beyond the walls of the museum. So these interactions that took place between strangers, and they were 20-minute one-on-one conversations, but they were really transformative, I guess, for the readers. And we heard several times how much they stayed with the readers long after the event was over. So I'm hoping some of you will take me up on my suggestion that you do your own human libraries. If you do, three quick pieces of advice. The first is, don't reinvent the wheel. The basic format of a human book, a reader, a 20-minute one-on-one conversation, has been going on, as I said, for 13 years, and it works, and go with it. The second is really take the time to meet with all of your potential human books before the event so that you choose people who you think will really thrive in that role as a human book. And the third is that I'd really encourage you all to ensure that the diversity of your particular communities are represented in your selection of human books, in whatever way that means, is meaningful for your community. So Thank you very much for listening to my talk. Have a good day.